From the archives of the greatest dramas in radio history, we proudly present Hollywood. The Radio Theater, starring Charles Coburn, Tom Drake, Beverly Tyler, Jim Cronin, and Dean Stockwell in The Green Years. Ladies and gentlemen, your producer, Mr. William Keeley. Greetings from Hollywood, ladies and gentlemen. Tonight, another MGM picture. An outstanding favorite is being presented on the stage. A thrilling drama that will live forever in our hearts. It's A.J. Cronin's masterpiece, The Green Years. And we are fortunate indeed in bringing you the original motion picture cast. Charles Coburn, Tom Drake, Beverly Tyler, Ewan Cronin, and Dean Stockwell. It's curtain time, and here's the play millions of you hope to see, The Green Years. Starring Charles Coburn as Grandfather Gow, Tom Drake as Roby, Beverly Tyler as Allison, Ewan Cronin as Mr. Lucky, with Dean Stockwell as the boy Roby. In the year 1900, Robert Shannon, orphan, aged 9 years, journeyed from Ireland to the town of Loganford in Scotland, there to make his new home with Mr. and Mrs. Lucky, the parents of his dead mother.
You're late, Mama. Supper's waiting.
I'm sorry, James. The lad's train was delayed.
I suppose you spent good money on the cab?
No, we just. Well, look up, Robbie. This is your grandfather.
Robert, no one regrets more than I that we meet under these circumstances. You call me Papa rather than Grandpa. We have one Grandpa in the house already.
He is my father, Robbie. Grandpa Gow. Well, this is Kate, dear, your aunt.
Don't look so sorrowful, dear. This is Miss Smith.
And this is your Uncle Murdoch.
I hope you like it here, Robbie.
Thank you.
Our other son, Adam, lives in London. A very successful insurance broker, Robert.
Well, it's hard for your boy coming to know us all at once.
He'll feel better after supper. Sit down. Oh, Heavenly Father, you've blessed me with this new responsibility, my grandson, Robert. You know, Lord, how his mother deceived me and married a wild, irresponsible Irishman. Not even of the faith of his household. Help me to carry this extra burden and deliver him from deceit, wild ways, and extravagance. Amen. Pass your plate. Boy has no belongings, Mama?
Nothing. Only a tricycle coming from Dublin, the carrier.
A tricycle? That improvident Irishman. Oh, that a daughter of mine had run off with a man who'd leave nothing but a tricycle. Well, he's the boy, then, are you? It's recent. Today's Friday.
The boy's not of our faith, Papa.
Oh. Hi.
It's just a new baby.
I'll take your meat, then. Waste not, want not.
Where will you be sending Roby to school, Papa?
It's the elementary, of course.
That is the truth. Daddy, if I have to
teach him. I'll hear no reflections, Kate, on a school that pays you 16 shillings a week.
Why can't you go to the academy?
The laddie comes to us with no money.
But you're the same, Mr. Christian. You don't want to be a sister superintendent
of sanitation all your life, Judy. Appearances. Aye, that's right. Well, Robert will go to the academy.
Well, Daddy, I do nothing to say. Thank you.
Hi. He doesn't want to eat. Let him go to bed.
Have you decided where he shall sleep? I still think Grandma Lucky's room will be best.
My mother pays good money for her room. She'll be home tomorrow, and you know she dislikes surprises.
Just sleep with Grandpa Gow, then, Robbie. Little bad boy. It's the last room at the end of the hall.
So you'll be Robert Shannon. Hey, there should be more of you.
Yes, Grandpa.
But certainly you don't have my hair. Your mother had my hair. You were lucky. If there's one thing I cannot abide, it's a crying laddie. Well, what might you be wanting?
That's what I was to keep with you.
Certainly. Well, is it your expectation to sleep with your clothes on? Get on there. Look at me, laddie. I will need a friend in this house. It's all right, boy. It's all right. Come along, Robbie. It's a fine black morning, and I'm taking you with me to my lawyer. On business.
Is he coming?
Aye. I'm off to see my lawyer.
Can you touch the key?
You don't know. Well, then touch it.
I can't. Papa says he's going to sell it.
What's that?
He says he often has got a key.
Someday, Robbie, I shall take this to Lucky in these two hands of mine, and I shall...
Oh, good morning,
Mr. Gow. Ah, Mrs. Bosomley. What a picture you make, madam. The sun shining like golden hop strings through your radiant hair. Have you had the honor of meeting my great-grandson, Robert?
Robert? Your grandpa's a poet.
And who wouldn't be the privilege to greet this loveliness of the morning?
Be off with your candy,
take my advice, Robbie. Enjoy the lady. The human race is better half. With a body, with a body, coming through the light. With a body, with a body.
Come in, Dundee. Come in.
I'll give about a minute, Robbie. Sit down there.
Yes, ma'am.
I say here, six documents, copy, Dundee, go. Are they ready?
There you are, Mr. Medicare. Sir, here they are.
Ah, okay. That's a lovely copy.
Here, copper case, too.
It's a pity you couldn't have done such a job on your first Dundee go as you have on your handwriting. Well, I'll credit this work for the rest.
Could you be letting me have, say, perhaps half a crown, sir?
And what did I tell your son-in-law, Mr. Lucky? You know the arrangement. The money I pay you to copy my legal papers goes to pay the premium on your life insurance.
I know, but perhaps it's true.
I see through your Dundee demon rump. No, not a penny. No, out with it.
Robbie, come here. Lad, this is Mr. McKellar. As fine and generous a man as you'll ever know. May I present my great grandson,
Robert? If you're ever in trouble, and heaven help us, you probably will be, why, you'll know who to come to.
Thank you, sir.
Dundee, I find there's a little item of half a crown, do you, after all?
Yeah. It's a trivial matter, lawyer. Thank you, sir, and good day.
Goodbye, Robert.
Goodbye, McKellar.
Oh, that's strange. I never noticed that establishment before.
What establishment, Robert?
Yes, the street there. What does that sign say, laddie?
The Green Barn. Look over there.
Oh, bless me, bless me. Obviously a place of refreshment. How would you like a nice glass of bubbling lemonade?
Thank you, Robert.
Excellent. I'll fetch you one. And then you can play. Yonder's the village green, see? Aye, there's a lucky boy. Lemonade and lassie. What more could you ask?
Hello. Hello. Good evening. Hello, this is my cousin. I'm going to see my grandpa. What's your name? Robert Stanley. I'm new here. I'm Alice McGee. What are you going to do when you grow up? I don't know. Do you? Of course. I'm going to marry a fine man. And have many fine children. Oh, where's my cousin now?
What
are you talking to, Alice? This is me, boy. This is Louisa. He's my
cousin. What's your little angel
up? It's Louisa's daughter.
Oh, you're a talking to, aren't you?
Yes.
Come on, Alice. Keep talking.
But that's all right.
I said, come on. You'll take some for that.
Did you have a nice time on the green, lad?
Yes, Senator.
Real laddie? What are you thinking about?
Anything. Where did you get those big red nose?
Nose? Big red nose? Why? Did you never hear of the Zulu War?
Senator, what's wrong with
you? Well, boy, I'm not the one to brag. But there we were, cut off in the jungle by the savage hordes of Zulu. Someone had to get a message through the relief column. I'll carry it, sir, cried. I took a revolver in each hand and a knife in the tooth. Quietly, I crawled across the rocky veldt. The jungle, that is. I was almost through the enemy line when they charged upon me by the score. I fired. Bam, 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 bam. Screaming, the savages fell back. But how long could the ammunition hold out? I flashed over the knife. Zip, zip, zip. Pops, he fired up at me. But the Zulus still came. And then...
Then
a sweet sight. Out of the dark of the night came running my great white charger, Athena. I leaped on her back. The Zulus gave chase. Flights of poison arrows darkened the air. I was wounded. I clung to my horse. Oh, that magnificent animal. He carried me to the relief column. Patient, bleeding, breathless. I fell into their arms with my message. The flag was saved.
And you were a hero, Grandpa?
They seemed to think so when the Queen, God bless her, decorated me at Balmoral Castle.
But, Grandpa, how did you get there to get married?
A poison spear, lad. A direct hit.
Oh, how wonderful. Where's he again?
Some other day, laddie. And there will be others. It's you and me together, my boy, in whatever the difficulty.
Yes, Grandpa.
And we're in difficulty this very moment.
Yeah?
Look up the street, Robin. Your grandma let me come home.
Let me try and fall into the clutches of that horrible old man.
Ah, here he is now. Come in, Robbie. Come in and be seen by your grandma, Letty.
You'll now be in the hands of a good Christian woman. So come to your grandma, Robert.
Mm-hmm.
Look, it is closed. Do you think you can go to the academy and ride?
But the laddie comes to us with no money. You're no suggestion I buy his clothes, are you?
You're my son, but you're a tight-fisted penny-pinching miser. Here, boy, here's a sugar.
Thank you.
Sit down, laddie. Don't drink. They last longer that way.
so. You've been coming up to your grandpa go.
Yes, Granny. It's only about the Union War and how you got a secret war.
The Union War.
So we put on an outside spear, a poison spear.
Aye, get some rum, it was. Come on, lads. First thing I'll do is make him for a new suit.
Oh,
never fear, boys. It'll make up just grand.
It's the color, Grandma. It's green and those flowers.
You'll not notice the flowers when it's done. Bedtime now, Robbie.
Good night, Grandma.
Where are you going?
To the other room.
You're sleeping with me, Robbie, from now on. Oh, and there's a thing or two you should know about that man. As well as indeed. That man's never set foot 50 miles from here. He's tagged for 10 all his life. Discharged from every situation he's ever held.
Grandma, no.
He's supported, like you said, by the charity of my son. Is it never fear? You're out of his influence now. No, into bed. I've got to get to work on your new suit. And don't forget, boys, the academy opens Monday.
Get home from school early, Robbie.
Grandpa, the police are going to school. I'll not go back there again.
No. The master's been up here. Is it that it? Mr. Reed?
No, Grandpa. It's the other boy.
Well, now, since Grandma Lexie thinks so much of you, isn't she the one you should be running to?
But it's too far. It's not me, Mr.
A green suit with flowers. Lady, you cannot blame the boys for laughing. But on the other hand, you cannot have them laughing at you. Now, will you do what I tell you?
Grandpa, I promise.
And who is the strongest, the most stubbornest, and the most independentest boy in the class?
Gavin Blair.
Well, then, you must meet Gavin Blair.
Papa, he's the only boy who lives here alone.
If you want to get on top, you must remove the top men. You'll fight this Gavin Blair, and you'll lick him.
Grandpa, I can't fight him.
Then I must write Mr. Reed and implore his protection of my weak little grandson.
No, Grandpa, no.
Well, then?
But I don't know how to fight.
What a lucky boy you are. Here I am. The man who stood toe-to-toe with Billy the Butcher. Winner of the famous 84 round bare-knuckle fight to the finish against Terrible Terry.
You, Grandpa?
Well, no, Billy the Butcher. But who held his coat, Come on, boy. Up with your feet. Chin down, lead with your left. We'll show this Gavin Blair. Aim at my nose now, boy. Aim at my nose.
Grandpa, your nose!
It's all right, lad, it's all right. I permitted you to strike me. And now you understand the importance of ducking. Well, come on, Robbie. Try it again.
Hello, Grandpa.
Hello, Robbie. You?
I'll fight the Gavin Blair, Grandpa.
Well, I've never seen a finer black eye, never.
But, Grandpa, I lost. Gavin licked me.
But obviously you did not run away. Here now, what's this?
It's my green suit.
There it is. But what's that suit you're wearing?
Gavin Blair, he gave it to me.
The boy who licked you?
He took me on after it. He likes me, Grandpa. There's blood all over the green suit.
Give me that emerald raiment. There, into the grate with it, Robbie, and good riddance. Ready, you can receive many a black eye in this life, but if you're a man, you'll no be the loser.
You mean a man already?
I do, aye. You're a man like your own grandpa, afeard of nothing. You can go your own way, attend your own church, and you can spit in any man's eye.
Robert?
Stand up to her, Robbie. Mind, you're a man, no?
Good work, Robert. You're going to play a meeting with... Where did you get that suit? And your eyes? Where did you get that eye?
In a fight, Grandma.
What did you do with the burly green suit on
it? We burned it. We didn't think Mr. Lackey would like to see it around. Blood on it. Not very sanitary.
And another thing. I'd better see the Sanders now on.
What's that?
I'm a man now.
This is your work, Mr. Brown, you beast of the field.
You heard what the laddie said. He's a man now. And in that case, madam, I don't think Mr. Lackey would approve of his sleeping in your room.
Oh,
look. Well, no, Robbie.
Well, I'm going to.
What is it you want, Robert? Can't you see I'm reading?
Robbie, dear, the superintendent of sanitation having a pack of golf balls. Now, who knows? One of these days, Papa may be wearing a double brain on his cap. And if that's to happen, Papa must be left to do his study in his place.
The pocket says I need 15 shillings.
We'll talk of it, Summer. 15 shillings?
Robbie, what for? For money and what?
My burdens. My responsibilities. You see this book? An encyclopedia of sanitation for which I had to pay 21 shillings. And now you ask me for 15 more.
I need to buy a suit. I mean, what's the problem? If you wouldn't have, then you make a 15.
Robert, I've been tolerant. I've let you attend the Church of Rome without interference or reproach. I'm a liberal man. But liberty can go too far. And when it starts costing money, I'm against it.
I'm sorry I bothered you.
I wish I had the money to give you, boy. You see, Robbie, it's very difficult for you. I live in the house of Mr. Lucky, and I pay no money for the rare privilege. I earn money copying papers for Mr. McKellar, but it all goes to pay my life insurance. I never see a penny of it.
Please, Grandpa, it isn't funny.
But it's important to get your new suit, so you could change your face. Why don't you go to the established church?
Grandpa, I couldn't.
Your Grandma Lucky would just love you if you did. There's no sense taking the hard way.
I believe I was glad to be, Grandpa.
If you'd said anything else, I'd have disowned you. Robbie, I'm a sinful and irreverent man with little interest in any church. But before I see you done out of your suit, I'll burn the town of Loganport.
Good day, Mr. Dow. A liberal period, is it?
I'm not buying a book, sir. I'm selling one. An encyclopedia of sanitation. I believe Mr. Lucky purchased this for 21 shillings.
He did?
Mr. Lucky says it is not comprehensive enough. He must have his money back.
Oh, there's some news now. I cannot give him more than 17 shillings.
I shall accept 15.
Eh?
It's a matter of justice.
I don't understand.
You don't have to. Take your book there and give me 15 shillings.
You did what, Mr. Dow? You did what with my encyclopedia?
I sold it, Mr. Lucky, for 15 shillings. And then I bought the boy a new suit.
That robbery. I'll have you arrested.
I was hoping you'd say that, Mr. Lucky. And what would the court say of a civil employee who robs an orphan lad of his tricycle and sells it for 15 shillings?
You deceitful old man.
I have just one more word, and if you ever dare to mention this to Robbie, I'll burn this house down at my first opportunity. Good day, Mr. Lucky.
Good day, Mr.
It's 5 years now since I first wrote in this diary. There was a flower show and fair yesterday. Alice and Keith sang. Later, Gavin and I danced with her. It's good to have friends like Gavin and Alice. It's almost June. In 2 weeks, I'll be graduated from the academy. The whole family will be there. Even Grandpa says he'll come. It'll be the first time he sat down with Lucky since seeing the glory of Jubilee.
And now, parents and friends, as we conclude our graduation exercises, it is with considerable pleasure that I make an award to our outstanding students. In my 11 years at the academy, not a single student has warranted this prize. Now, at last, Loganport possesses a young scientist, who, I prophesy, someday will be a great doctor. And Mr. Robert Cannon, the special medal in science.
Thank you, Mr. Reed.
Good work, Green Britches. Good luck.
It seems strange, doesn't it? All those years in the academy, and now we're walking home together for the last time.
Well, Gavin, have you noticed what's true in such an occasion?
I. Brody, my father still wants you to come with us to look into it.
Listen, thanks, Gavin, but I can't.
But the farm will be running.
I've got a job starting Monday.
A job?
The boiler works. Kate, she's married now, you know. Kate tells me she can get me into the machine shop.
The boiler works? Oh, Robbie, what's the matter with you?
There's no chance at all you're coming to the university.
No, Gavin.
When do you leave for Los Angeles?
Tomorrow.
Well, here's the big. Good luck here, Robbie. You too, Alice.
Thanks.
Goodbye, Gavin. I'll write to you.
You're missing me. It's a bunny, no?
Aye.
It's a bunny, Kate. You can never even walk on. Listen.
Aye.
Put your head over here beside mine. Put my heart. It's such a romantic thing.
Aye.
Aye, they tell me there's a special water port on that river.
Robbie, isn't there a chance in the world that you can go on with your studies? Mr. Reed thinks you're going. If you haven't even occurred to him, Mr. Reed.
I have obligations, Alice. Mm. The Lucky's aren't rich.
Well, they're not poor, but they're still poor. I guess it's the same. Oh, you're the most exasperating person I ever knew. But you're bound to be a doctor. You know it, Robbie, but no, it's the boiler work. Just because it's interesting.
Oh, to be a doctor. To have a laboratory of my own. Well, at least you're not going away.
No. I'll study my thing here in Loganport for a while anyway.
The moon is rising.
My mother says that in Scotland, not even the moon is visible.
Now, what would you mean by that?
Don't you know? Is he the cleverest boy in Logansville?
Our dear.
He was a fool.
I mean, would it be all right? Could I put my arm over you?
Yes, you would, won't you?
It is a bonny night.
Oh, no. A bonny night.
In a moment, we'll return with Act Two of The Green Years, starring Charles Cogan, Tom Zwick, Beverly Tyler, and Jean Cullen.
Occasionally, the United States Senate chamber is illuminated by a glimmer of humor, like the time word reached the Senate that certain interests in Hong Kong were making commercial use of the works of American songwriters without paying the customary composer royalty fees. After investigating, the lawmakers designed a bill to protect Tin Pan Alley. Sponsors of the measure were Senators Russell Long of Louisiana, Hawaii's Hiram Fong, William Fong from Virginia, and Edward Long of Missouri. The legislation was introduced on the Senate floor as the Long Fong Spong Long Hong Kong Song Bill. On another occasion, Congress honored Robert Frost with an award recognizing his contributions to American letters. In presenting a medal to Mr. Frost, the late President Kennedy took note of the unanimous vote on the matter and concluded, "It's the only thing Congress has agreed on for a long time." Two of the lighter moments that really happened on Capitol Hill.
Act Two of The Green Year, starring Charles Cogan as Grandfather Gow, Tom Zwick as Wilbur, Beverly Tyler as Allison, and Hugh Kernan as Mr. Lucky. For a month now, Robert Shannon has labored in the boiler works at Logansville. But one night, grimy and tired, he meets a friend as he leaves the factory. 10 minutes later, breathless and excited, he bursts into Allison's house.
Robbie, what is it?
I just saw him, Allison. Mr. Reed. Oh, you don't know what's happened. He's arranged for me to sit for the marshal. The marshal's scholarship. I've been studying medicine, Allison.
Oh, Robbie.
Well, I haven't won it yet. I can't win, it's impossible, but I can try. Oh, Allison.
Robbie, I don't know if you're kissing me, but I couldn't get away with a week of tenure.
No, no, I don't.
It's such a wonderful thing.
I didn't know what I was doing. Excited. Goodbye, Allison. I'll see you later.
Robbie, a scholarship. I don't tell you how much.
100 times a year. For 5 years, Mama.
What's this paper, Robbie?
And Mr. Reed gave it to me for you to sign. Mr. Smith informed me to try for the scholarship.
Well, Robbie, you must understand something well.
I've no had an easy time of it.
Murdoch, after all, has spent his education works in that nursery raising flowers. No more money for board from Grandma Letty since she's gone to Kilmarnock. No financial aid from Katie now she's married, and Grandpa Gow is still upstairs with an appetite like a growing boy. Even Adam. Adam, my own son, a great, successful man in London, owing me £50 for 12 years now.
He'll pay.
He'll pay indeed. Mama, I've resolved. I'm going to London. I'll collect that £50 if it takes the whole 4 weeks of my holiday to do it.
We were speaking of a scholarship, Papa.
I cannot let you go for 5 years more without a penny return for the support of the house.
No, I won't have it. I won't have it. You must let him. You can't sell Robbie's life and hopes for a few pennies from the boiler works.
Mama, you spoke of money.
I'm doing this for your own good, Robbie.
You're reaching above your station in life, and you'll reach not but disappointment.
No. No, I cannot sign the paper.
Come in.
Are you Mr. Jason Reed?
I am. Sit down, Mr. Gow.
Mr. Reed, I'm not merely Robert Shannon's great-grandfather. I'm a defender of the rights of man. I tell you, sir, when a man thinks low enough to deny these rights, I protect. And if you are among these worms who would deny the boy an education, I tell you I shall not stand by and countenance such a sin.
And I must tell you, Mr. Gow, that the laddie cannot be entered for the scholarship only because Mr. Leckie had denied permission.
Then we'll enter him on the quiet.
The entry must be signed by his guardian.
I'll sign it.
Mr. Gow, have you lost your wit?
I still have the wit to sign my own name.
Under that fool Leckie's nose?
I'll send Leckie away. I might even send him to London.
This is the most unbelievable and dangerous nonsense I've ever heard. But I'm with your heart and soul. Here, take these books, sir, over. Let him start with these till Leckie goes to London. Now, off with you.
Mr. Reed, we'll mine like ours. We'll tear them to pieces.
I'm going to London with Papa. I've made up my mind.
Oh, Mama.
And you will have nothing to interfere with your studying for the scholarship, because I'll see to it the book come back till the middle of August.
Mama,
Who told you?
Never mind. Good luck, Robbie dear.
I'm so tired, Mr. Reed. I've studied so long. I've read so much. I swear I don't know anything now.
I haven't even begun. All right, now mathematics. What is a conic section?
The intersection of a plane with a cone.
Plumbly. What's the formula for the surface of a sphere? All right, boys. Paper. Come now, paper. Pencil. Trace the growth of industrial Europe. Causes. Effects. Think, boys. Think. Distinguish between density and specific gravity. Between kinetic and potential energy. What were Newton's three laws of motion? Think.
Describe the chief product of a Daniels value.
What to do? Oh. The examination starts tomorrow. What to do? According to Mr. Reed, only second graders study for last minute.
Yes, ma'am.
Well, come along. We're going to take a long walk. You and I and the professor. When did the train leave, Logan?
Tonight at 8 o'clock. But I'll be back tomorrow night.
All the examinations on one day?
No, I'll go back to Glasgow Sunday. Then physics on Monday. Allison, what do you do when you grow up?
I told you that once, long ago. I'll marry a fine man and have many fine children. What do you do?
Would you say we're grown up now?
No, Robbie. Not quite yet.
Allison.
Please, Robbie. I think perhaps you'd better concentrate on the decline and fall of the Roman Empire.
All I can keep in mind is how much I want to kiss you.
Then, perhaps you'd better kiss me, Robbie. I suppose. Oh, my Robbie. You'll win the scholarship, you will. I love you.
Telegram from Glasgow University. Well, tell me.
History?
92%. You missed only one question in geometry. Roby, you know what this means.
We know.
You've still got the examination on Monday, but I swear to you on the basis of what you've done, if you only get 50% in physics, you'll win the market. Mr. Gow, you wouldn't have a drink in the house.
Not until Monday.
Now, what about that cough, Roby?
Oh, it's just a cold. He's a wee bit warm on the side.
Well, I'll stop by the doctor. I've got the rest now anyway. Goodbye, Roby.
Goodbye. He'd best stay in bed. Is that it, Doctor?
Man, you're daft. He'll get this prescription to the chemist right away.
Robbie has examinations Monday and Gatsby. You think by then...
The temperature's 104. Mr. Gallia's grandson's on the verge of pneumonia.
How are you feeling, Robbie?
Oh, I'm fine, Mr. Reed. The doctor said I could go out today. 10 days I've been in bed now.
Yes, boy, I know. Robbie, I wrote to the university. I asked if you may take your examination when you've recuperated.
Mr. Reed, well, why didn't you tell me?
Because they've refused. I went myself to Glasgow yesterday. I went down on my knees to them. If there's any consolation, they've ranked you second.
Oh. Thank you, sir.
I begged them to give you an average on your physics, but no, they're guided by rules, not by justice. Well, you're young, something else will turn up. There's Allison here, she wants to see you.
Okay.
Take care, laddie.
Allison... You know.
Yes, Robert, but there's more bad news. Robin Dale.
But what's happened?
He was coming to see you, Robin. He told you all. He was running for the train. He slipped. He's dead, Scott.
Dead? Dead?
Robin, where are you going? Robin!
Something. Dad would have stayed for anything to happen. Something happened out of nowhere and you make no sense. Why? Why did it happen?
Come in, Allison. Come in.
Grandpa already finished the concert now, didn't he?
Is it likely he'd miss it with you, I suppose? As a matter of fact, he's coming as my guest on his money. As a music lover of long standing, I shall never allow myself to miss a rendition of Hamlet's Messiah.
Handel isn't fine.
Well, that's what I said.
Grandpa, there's a famous teacher coming to the concert. If he likes my voice, Mother will insist on my going to the conservatory at Edinburgh. Oh, I don't want to go, Grandpa. I don't want to leave Robert.
He'll be coming back, Lassie.
But he's the one that should be studying, not I. Oh, Grandpa, what a fine doctor he could be. And when I think of him down at that boiler works, I...
There's things, Lassie, that no one can stop, good or bad.
But what about Susan?
Don't tell him till the concert's over. You know, who knows? Perhaps you'll make such an eternal mess of it, there'll be nothing to worry about.
It was like an angel, Allison. You're singing tonight. I was never so proud.
Roger, he's a priest.
I.
Roger, I...
Oh, you needn't say it. Grandpa told me. You're going away.
Dr. Edinburgh.
Oh, you'll go further than that?
No, Roger, no.
I heard you sing tonight.
Then I'll not leave here at all.
Oh, you must.
Oh, Roger, say the word. I'll see you marry me.
How can I pass? How could I?
Do you love me, don't you? If you love me, then put me on me.
What would I be doing for you if I married you? I know my place. Whether I'm suited or not, whether I choose it or not, I have a place at the boiler works, and I'll not share it with you. Oh, Alison, if I loved you less, it might be different. You're young. I suppose we'll get over it.
I may be young for you. I'm likewise tired. Would you take me home, though?
Robbie, come in. We've been looking all over for you.
Papa.
Dr. Gregory.
Mama, Robbie. She's very ill.
Happened so sudden.
Her heart and body can tolerate just so much wear and tear, Robbie.
Worn out. That's what she is.
Worn out. There's nothing I can do. It's in God's hands now.
Robbie, I'll be in my room, Papa.
You'll pray for her, Robbie. Light the candle by your shrine. Pray for her, Robbie.
I've doubted my redeemer. Forgive me. Punish me, Lord, but not Mama. Never doubted me. Oh, let her live and have some peace. I ask you. I make this bargain. Let her live and I'll never doubt again. Never.
Robin, she's gone, right? She's gone and left.
Is that you, Robert Shannon?
Yes, Father Roach.
I was just coming to your house, Rad. I heard Mrs. Leslie was in.
She's dead.
God rest her. Robert, what's that said to me?
All my life I've worn this. But I'm throwing away now. I'm weary of metal.
This may be God's way of testing you, of showing you the way you must go.
What way?
Into the priesthood, my son.
If God didn't want me to be a doctor, it's too late to oblige him by being a priest.
It's never too late to turn to God.
I don't believe in God.
God believes in you, Robert.
I don't believe in God anymore.
In a moment, we return with the third act of The Green Year, starring Charles Coben, Tom Drake, Beverly Tyler, and Hume Cronin.
Songs, and of course, tender songs. One of the greatest songs to come out of World War I falls into the last category, the ballad, Till We Meet Again, written by Richard Whiting. When he first wrote the song, he was so dissatisfied that he threw it away. Fortunately, his wife had faith in her husband's ability, so she retrieved the manuscript and sent it off to the publisher. Since that time, the song has sold more than 11 million copies in one form or another. Whiting had other famous offsprings, of course. Sleepy Time Gal, Ain't We Got Fun? Louise, popularized by Maurice Chevalier. Not to mention his own vocalist offspring, Margaret Whiting. But it's Till We Meet Again, which has left its mark on the musical and non-musical world. So aptly was The Bittersweetness of Parting, captured by Richard Whiting.
Mr. Keeley at the microphone.
Act three of The Green Year, starring Charles Coburn as Grandfather Gow, Tom Drake as Roby, Beverly Tyler as Allison, and Jim Cronin as Mr. Lucky. All in a few months, Robert Shannon's modest world has cast on about him, one disaster after another. Morose now in silence, ignoring everyone, even Grandfather Gow, Robert works on in a foundry, sharing a word for his family, only when he comes home at night to suffer.
You're late, Roby.
Am I?
It isn't enough in my old age to have to come back here. No, I must care for a handful of men who come late to me. Where's Mother?
We won't wait for him. We'll eat.
And that old man upstairs, what of him?
I'll take him, please.
No, you'll not. He eats downstairs with the rest of us, or he'll not eat at all.
Sit down. You're late, Mother.
Where's Grandpa?
He's in his room.
Are you sure? Look at this.
Grandpa's hat, Tyler's hat. Found floating on the common pond.
I'll look upstairs.
Grandpa!
They found his coat by the footbridge. When did you see him last?
I don't recollect, Murdoch. The man avoids me. The common pond, did you say? Murdoch, is it possible?
I say anything is possible the way he's been treated.
Yes, Roby. Well,
that's not been kept.
He's gone my noggin day and night, and you threatened to send him to the workhouse.
Workhouse? Papa wouldn't do that.
And what do you know about it? When have you been home, safe to eat and sleep?
Well, I support him. I pay his keep. Papa's got no right.
Now, you pay your seat, but you treat him like a stranger. Like you treat everybody since Allison went away.
Murdoch, you think he'd...
Why would he wish to live any longer? Now he's been after the misery of the paper. He's been looking forward to the flower show and the fair. He thinks my coronation's for his own. I just don't know.
Well, I do. There's no security. We must wire for Adam. First thing, devoted to the old man he was. And he knows all about the insurance. Robbie, where are you going, boy?
I'm going out.
You'll send that telegram for me.
I'll send it, Papa.
If I don't find him.
Another day, no sign of him yet. Oh. So you came, Adam.
I'm glad to see you, Roby.
No trace at all, Roby.
I've looked everywhere, Kate.
He was a fine man, a lovely man.
We're hoping Grant is still alive, Adam.
The insurance will be paid, Papa. Taxed on the spot.
Oh, Roby, how my heart breaks for you.
I was just saying, Mrs. Boothamley, a finer man never breathed.
He had his fault. A weakness or two. But what of that?
Why don't you say what you're really thinking? That he's worth more to you dead than alive. I'm shocked with you, Roby. Where's your manners?
Papa, Mr. McKellar's here.
Oh, Lawyer McAllister, come in, come in.
The police are just outside the door here, Mr. Lucky. They'd like to speak to you.
The police?
Aye, they found Gandhi Gow. He's been in jail. Bring him in, Constable.
It's Grandpa. In jail?
Mr. Gow. Mr. Gow, you're intoxicated.
I am, Mr. Lucky. Robby Ladd and Mrs. Boothamley. She walks in beauty like the night. Of cloudless climes and starry skies.
Quite a wonderful.
Dear family and friends, and you, Madam Lucky, forgive me. Robby, are you not coming with me?
Oh, Grandpa.
In a body, coming through the light. In a body.
Good morning, Grandpa.
Here, your medicine. Why can't you content yourself with beating me to death? Now get out of my way. I'm getting up and getting dressed.
You're staying in bed?
Do you think there's going to be a flower show and a rug and a fair in Logansport and me not in attendance?
You know what the book has said.
You know it's words like the last one you'll meet with an anchor. That will be an embarrassing meeting for both of us.
And, Grandpa, you've got to keep off the whiskey.
On my honor as a gentleman, Robby, why, I've not had a drop for days.
Except for that bottle under your mattress.
Hey.
No, I'll stay home with you, Grandpa.
Go on.
No.
Go on and enjoy yourself.
No, I'll keep you company. I won't go.
If you stay in this house, I'll never speak to you again. Get out. Just leave me here to die all by myself.
Look, Papa. It's Grandpa. Marching there with the home guard. And it is here. Mr. Zell. Here.
And contrary to my explicit instructions, and look, take a note of his sleeve. A whiskey bottle. Oh, that man. That wretched man. Robbie, I'll take care of him, Papa.
Allison. Allison, what are you doing here? Away from Edinburgh.
You'd answered my letter and you wouldn't know more about me.
Well, anyway, I'm glad you're back.
It's only for today. I couldn't miss the train.
Neither could Grandpa.
Is he here?
Yes, and I've got to find him. Allison, first night see you in a few minutes.
I'll be here, Rosie.
I'll get Grandpa and take him to Murdoch.
I'll be right back.
Step up, Eddie. Have a glass with your grandpa's friend.
Grandpa, put your glass down and come here. Grandpa, Allison's here.
Aye?
Can I trust you just for a few minutes?
Why, laddie, for eternity.
Grandpa, how do you do it?
Do what?
I'm 18 years old. Compared to you, I'm an old man. How do you do it, Grandpa? I'd like to know.
You're in the green years, Robbie. You suffer the critical disease of being young. The Lord deliver me from ever having to go through that again. Well, go on, find your lassie. I'll not budge him in.
No, we'll go to Murdoch. You got a stall at the flower exhibit.
Get me one of Murdoch's carnations, Robbie, will you? I don't feel well.
You won't do me this favor?
Robbie, I'd like to, laddie, but I don't think I can. Robbie.
Grandpa. Grandpa!
You're Robert Cannon. I knew one day you'd be back in church again.
You dead, Father Holt?
My great-grandfather.
Yes, lad. I hear.
He was a man of many follies, but he was incapable of meaning.
He never bargained with God.
He could do things because he enjoyed doing them. Oh, do you think the God who understood my great-grandfather might forgive me?
I haven't doubted you. He will forgive you.
I should like to pray with you, Robert.
Grandmalecki, Papa, Katie, Murdoch. Well, now that we're home, I want you to know that I think it was a fine funeral. A fine funeral.
Mm-hmm. Oh, will you stop it, Adam?
Hush, girl. Yes, Adam. Expenses.
For Katie.
May I come in?
Mr. McKellar, make yourself comfortable.
I don't leave, Rosie.
Yes, this hardly concerns him. We're about to take up the matter of the will. If you'll excuse
me. I want the entire family present.
Now, according to my figures, the insurance comes to a matter of £658, 12 shillings and sixpence.
And the round number.
Exactly. We must say it, Papa. He was a fine man.
Oh, I...
Sitting, Robert. You respected him before he died. You might respect him now.
I'm going to read the will.
But there's no need, sir. We all know what's in it.
It's a very simple document. He left all he possessed, or the insurance, that is, to your late wife. And in the event of her death, to her executor, yourself.
That's proper.
Mm. There's a codicil, however. The codicil was drawn shortly after Robert Cannon failed his examination for the university. Sandy Gow left everything he possessed to Robert Cannon.
He was insane.
He was as sane as I am, saner.
He couldn't do that. It's not legal.
It is legal if it's around, Papa.
I'll take it to law. Do so, Mr. Leckie. I do so, and I promise you I'll fight you in the county court. I'll fight you in the high court. I'll fight you to the floor of Parliament itself.
Robert, it was Gandhi Gow's hope that you'd kindle some wisely on your education. But I seem to mind in saying, a sort of afterthought it was, that if you preferred to invest it in wine, women, and song, that was your privilege.
Oh,
at last, Allison. At last, I stand before thee. The great gate to the University of Glasgow.
Give me your hand,
Robert. My hand.